Praise the Lord, everyone.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Come on and give the Lord a hand and praise. God is a good God. We're thankful to be here.
We're another day
in the land of the living. We are thankful because God is a good God, isn't he?
Amen.
He's always taking good care of us. He continues to do that day by day, week by week, and year by year. And so we're honored just to be in the service of the Lord, a blessing. And we're humbled to be here. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. There's many people that didn't make it, but we are the ones who did. Amen?
Amen.
Thank God for jobs. We thank God for homes. Thank God for automobiles. And so for that, we are grateful. Are you grateful today? Amen. Amen. So we're going to open up with prayer, and we're going to call on Bishop Abram if he would come and open us up with prayer. Let's receive him at this time.
Can we say amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. If you could stand, please stand. If not, just bow your heads and we'll pray. Father God, we love you. We praise you and give you thanks this morning. We bless your name for waking us up. Realize that many didn't wake up to see this day. But you're mindful of us, and we're thankful.
Yes.
Now remember your people far and near. We pray for the services today. Look on our pastor, Pastor John Lee. Anoint him afresh as he brings forth the word of God. And co-pastor Lady Danetta, bless them as they labor in the vineyard, doing kingdom work. Now, Father, we pray for those who are in the hospitals and nursing homes and in the persecuted church also, the saints who are going through persecutions. Some are being killed. And all of these things, remember them, Lord. And we ask that you would remember our city, our nation, that people, including ourselves, would repent and seek your face, realizing, Lord, you're soon to come.
Yes.
There's flooding in some places. Hurricanes have been going on. Fires. And I believe that you're trying to get our attention. Amen. That we'll draw closer to you. Let us do it. And we just thank you. Now remember the unsaved and those who are hurting. Heal them. Heal the brokenhearted. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. And amen.
Prayers always in order. We always need prayer as a part of our life, an opportunity to talk to our Heavenly Father. And so we're going to read a scripture, Philippians 4:4-9, in the King James Version, Philippians 4:4-9. If you have a Bible, feel free to look that up or on your devices. It says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Rejoice, let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are good, of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things, those things which ye have both learned and received, and heard and seen in me. Do, and God of peace shall be with you. How many believe that?
Amen.
Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand praise. Come on now, let's give him a hand praise. He's worthy. He's a worthy God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are thankful to be here. We just want to encourage each and every one of you to worship with us. Amen. Praise God with us. If the Lord is leading you, or different plans before, walk around, jump. Let the Lord know that you appreciate him. Raise your hand. Sing with the praise team. Amen. So we're going to do some meet and greet. Let's take a few moments and do meet and greet and tell somebody you are thankful to see them. Amen.
Hi there. Uh-huh. I'm good.
I like
I'm Tim.
I'm going to go to the hospital.
To come back and serve him. So
For God I live and for God I die.
Amen.
I love you and just pray for me. Pray for my sanity.
Praise the Lord. Let's give God another hand of praise.
This time of praise, we will worship the Lord in song. Amen. Good to know who the Lord is this morning. It's good to have you as a friend. Amen. What a blessing to know who Jesus is. Keeps us in perfect peace this morning. Will our minds stay on Him?
Just to know Him.
God praise.
Just to know him. Just to know him.
He's Jesus Christ.
It may look like I'm surrounded.
victory. This is how I fight my battles. 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 This is how I fight my battles.
Let's give God a hand of praise. How many know power and prayer? Yes. Carnal, but divine. Hallelujah. Thank you. Keep praying, church. God is faithful.
Amen.
Come on, we want you to worship with us. Praise God because He's worthy. Do you believe that?
Amen.
Clap your hands if you believe it. Amen.
Lord, we thank you for the
give God his praise. And we say hallelujah, give God the victory. This is his house today. Let's give him praise. I want somebody give it to mind and tell him you love him this morning. The praises go up, the blessings come down today. Father God, come into this place. We thank you for the Holy Spirit. Thank you for the love and your mercy this morning. Come on, let's give God a little more praise. He's worthy of the glory and the honor this morning. He's a good God. Hallelujah. Thank you. God bless you. Praise the team. Good to see you. We are going to get right into the Word today. If you have your Bible, let's go to the first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis, the 13th chapter. If you haven't been through Genesis, I would encourage you to, even if you can't get through the whole Old Testament, I think it's good to know how they started. Amen. We call Genesis the book of beginnings. One author called it the seed plot of the Bible. Every Christian doctrine is found there, justification by faith, Jesus Christ as our high priest, the shed blood of the Lamb as a sacrifice for our sin, justification, sanctification, glorification is all found in the book of Genesis. Thank God for you here that are faithful to God. We honor you today as we honor God. The Bible says that the praise ought to come from another person's lips and not our own. So as the pastor, I give you thanks for your faithfulness to God. Amen. Faithfulness to church and faithfulness to God, they go right together. Amen. Don't let anybody fool you. Genesis, the 13th chapter, we'll read from the King James Version, if that's all right. And I will read the first 12 verses. I'm going to try to teach and take some time. Hopefully we keep you awake. Genesis 13. I think historically that's a trouble. You see, you know, 13 is trouble. There's a little trouble here, but we thank God because he's always able to make good things come about, even when we go the wrong way. Amen. We also said amen to that. Genesis 13, and Abram, somebody say Abram, went up out of Egypt, he and his wife and all that he had, and Lot with him into the south. And Abraham was very rich in cattle, in silver, and in gold. And he went on his journey from the south even to Bethel, to the place where his tent had been at the beginning, between Bethel and Hai. To the place of the altar which he had made there at the first. Apparently he had been there before. And Abraham called on the name of the Lord. And Lot also, which went with Abram, had flocks, herds, and tents, and the land was not able to bear them. And they went, and they might dwell together, for their substance was great, so that they could not dwell together. And there was a strife between the herdmen, the cattlemen of Abram's cattle, and the herdmen of Lot's cattle. And the Canaanite and the Perizzite dwelled them then in the land. Part of the reason we don't want to fuss and argue as Christians because other people are watching. And they ain't got no good intent for us anyway. So he's a husband and a wife, sister, brother. You make sure you treat them good. Other folks is watching. And they mean more harm than we do when we get through this thing. The Canaanites and the Perizzites. They're arguing and folks are watching. And Abram said unto Lot, let there be no strife between us. Someone got to be spiritual here. I pray thee between me and thee and between my herdmen and thy herdmen, for we be brethren. Is not the whole land before us? Separate thyself, I pray thee, from me. If thou wilt take the land, then I will go to the right, or if thou depart to the right hand, then will I go to the left. Wherever you go, I ain't going. That's what the whole idea there is. I'm going the opposite direction, family or not. And Lot lifted up his eyes and beheld all the plain of the Jordan, that it was well watered. everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, even as the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, and as thou comest unto Zoar. Verse 11, then Lot chose him all the plain of the Jordan, the well-watered area, and Lot journeyed east, and they separated themselves the one from another. And Abram dwelt in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelt in the cities of the plain, and pitched his tent toward Sodom. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading, hearing, and understanding of his word, the teaching and preaching of his word. You may be seated in Jesus' name. I want to teach today from a familiar topic of mine, is that a made-up mind. Somebody said made-up mind. To serve the Lord. Let's say that again. Say a made-up mind. Say it like your mind is made up. A made-up mind. You gotta have a made-up mind to serve God. You can't serve God with no halfway mind. This ain't the hokey pokey. You can't have one foot in and one foot out. Amen. Hallelujah. And shake it all about. No, you gotta have a made-up mind. Hallelujah. I got a couple of folks here that got a made-up mind today. Serve the Lord. Wife don't want no husband that ain't got a made-up mind. Oh, let me just go back. A girlfriend don't want no boyfriend that ain't got no made-up mind. Boyfriend ain't want no girlfriend that ain't got no made-up mind, Brother D. You gotta make up your mind what you want. Hallelujah. Hokey pokey, folks. We don't want to be hokey pokey. The Bible says a double-minded man is unstable. And ladies, I don't know if you know, but a double-minded woman is unstable.
Amen.
Amen. There are things in life where we can be indecisive and count on God and others to help us. But there is something that requires all of you, and that is serving the Lord. And if you think for 1 minute that we can serve God halfway, it'll never work. The Bible says the reason is because of God himself. He's jealous. You ever had a jealous maid or somebody who was after you and wouldn't let you go? You know that's trouble. And I believe all of us have. Had an old girlfriend that we couldn't shake. Boyfriend you couldn't get rid of. Don't mean to talk down verb, but the graveyards are full of people who are there because somebody got jealous. From the very first time man was set on earth, there are two main reasons for murder, and it's money and love. And God loves us so much that he has said in his heart that we are going to be his. When he set his affection on us, he decided that I am yours and you are mine. Hallelujah. And it's not like one of our earthly relationships that we can quickly get rid of, quickly ignore, and quickly abandon. But when God sets his eyes on you, there are trouble comes when we go the opposite direction. Because he is a jealous God. Hallelujah. And that jealous God is not like a jealous man. He has nothing but good thoughts for us when he gets jealous. He has nothing but our best intentions when he gets jealous. But we find out that when we look into the text, we are dealing with a man named Abram. Later, his name would be changed to Abraham, and the H A just means inspiration. God inspired Abraham at a point in his life and changed his name, but he did more than change his name. He changed his life. You see, there's two points in the part of a person's life. The point when they believe on Jesus and the Holy Spirit comes into them. Okay. Oh, yeah. Then there's a point where you are filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. That can be years apart, you see. But when the Holy Spirit fills you, you're called to service. Some of us are just, the Lord has come into us. But as the book of Acts shows, there's a point when he fills you. And when he fills you to your purpose. He puts the ha in your name. It takes the work of the Lord to do the work of the Lord. It takes the Holy Spirit to be in service to God. Hallelujah. And this ain't something we did. This is something God did. Prior to Abraham, with his encounter with God, he had just trusted God. God had come into him. But we find out after years of service to God and failing God, Abraham failed God like everybody else. He's the father of our faith. He sits atop three largest strands of religion in the world. And surprise, about 75% of everybody who has faith, Christianity, Judaism, and Islam, all of those venerate, honor the man Abraham, who was a real person, person that lived. The Judaism and the Jews honor him as a great prophet, someone who was called by God, the father of their faith. The Christianity, we see him as our father, and the one, the progenitor of our faith. Jesus, the Lord called him the father of our faith, and that he was justified by faith. The Bible said that Abraham believed in the Lord, and it was counted unto him as righteousness. How many are you thankful that your righteousness came by believing? It wasn't your works that got you to stand with the Lord. It was the fact that you believed in him. Hallelujah. Abraham believed in the Lord. God said everything is all right. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I love justification by faith. Of course, the men of Islam believe that Abraham was a great prophet. They call him Ibrahim, not Abraham, but Ibrahim. And they believe that he come to Allah, who we call God the Father, but he came to Allah. So what we have is three large strands of faith who all call Abraham Father. So that means that we are all children of the same faith. Hallelujah. You say, well, why do they argue, brother? Well, this is the problem with Islam and Muslims and the Jews and Judaism and Christianity. Why the war and the discord there in the Middle East? Maybe it's just sibling rivalry. That's a real thing, sibling rivalry. But this, to be a little more serious, most of that issue now has turned from really being religious to just being political. They don't really have no faith anyhow. It's just a political thing. So they're going to keep on fighting. But we need not talk about them. We do enough fighting right here in America. We got enough stuff going on right here in between our states, so we don't need to talk about them. Nevertheless, when we look into the Bible, we see a lesson on backsliding from the life of Lot. And I just want to start the lesson today that whomever you are, if you have faith, you have an experience of backsliding. That no one in Christian faith has ever got from beginning to end without backsliding. It is not something we want to continue in our lives, but we're all guilty. We are all guilty of not trusting God. We are all guilty of disobeying God. We don't need to look from birthday to birthday. There's plenty of times in between one birthday to the next birthday where we can say we weren't listening to the Lord. But as we progress in faith, we want to grow up in our faith. The Bible lets us know in this text, Abraham found himself back at the same place. You see, you can prosper physically and not be pleasing to God. Amen. You can get the things that you want, and you can store up a storehouse of things and find out that in the course of those things, I have not grown any closer to God. He doesn't let us pass grades. We have to pass each step. You know, I had a brother, and God bless him. He failed a grade. He thought it was not fair. He said, the teacher didn't do me right. And they went in and passed and pumped him right back up. But for a year, we was in the same grade. But he went and told him, he said, I ain't got no business back here with these folks. And so they gave him a passing grade because they seen his passion. And of course, he had to do a little work to get back. They just didn't give it to him, Brother D. They said, if you finish courses and you retake some courses in the summer, God is going to make you retake a course until you pass it. That's what I'm trying to say today. And until we decide that, Lord, I'm going your way, we ain't no backsliding and promotion go together in faith. There is no godly gain that is associated with going back. We serve a progressive God, a going forward God. Everything we see in life is growing and growing and growing and growing until it dies. So God spiritually wants us to grow up. in him. So when we backslide, we are going against the design of what God wants for us. The Bible says when we backslide, it is like a dog eating his own vomit. He ain't supposed to eat your own vomit. It's like a pig returning back to the mire, back to the mud. Church of God, if we go back to the weak and beggarly things, we're not in the will of God. If God delivered us from something, the problem with Israel was that God got them out of Egypt, but he couldn't get Egypt out of them. Hallelujah. I know God saved them today and delivered them, but we got to work on getting some things up out of us. We can be pleasing to God. How in the world have some people gotten out of church? Look around as a pastor, and you try not to be too rough on folks. So involved in sinful things of the world. I'm talking about God's people. Hallelujah. That they came to a place, often a particular place in their life, where they began to seek their own way instead of God's way. Operating in the flesh, no longer trusting God, no longer leaning on God for even the basic answers. Hallelujah. But the Bible encourages us that we ought to pray without ceasing. Hallelujah. Our everything that we do ought to be mixed with prayer. That whatever we do, we do it in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I got any believers this morning? Hallelujah. We can lift up the name of Jesus and say, Lord, when I trust you, it's always auspicious. When we trust him, it's always good. I got a testimony like you that sometimes we do the wrong thing and God still works it for my good. But that's not to discount the call of God to walk in all of his ways. I've never trusted God and been dissatisfied with the answer. I've never put my trust in God and been unhappy with the outcome. But on the opposite, the Bible said, the blessing of the Lord make rich and add no sorrow to it. I found out when I disobey the Lord, when I disobey his word, there's always a sorrow. There's never a middle ground when we don't obey the Lord and clear commands from God. Hallelujah. I don't mean to scare you this morning. I'm trying to bless you this morning. Anybody going to have a made up mind to serve God? This is what it's going to take. We come to a place in our lives as believers sometimes where we begin to see our own way rather than God's way. And from then it's just a downward step, one after another. Let me say that the backsliding in Lot's life, we know how his wife was turned to a pillar of salt and he almost slept with family members. It was one thing after another. So when we see our sister, our brother headed in the clear wrong direction, refused to receive any instruction, still go saying no to the same thing God said yes to, because we'd rather do it our way than God's way. The Bible says that the backslider in his heart is filled with his own way. You say, what is the problem with my own way? Because it's not God's way. That's Proverbs 14:14. We make a conscious decision to pursue our own personal things that we desire and that we want in contrast to what God wants for our life. Amen. And if you're honest, the thing that you prayed about, the jobs, the relationship, the promotion, that everything you prayed about, God answered was a blessing to you. Amen. When you got on your knees and you said, God, I need you to move, God moved and you have a testimony that God is good. But on the contrast, when we haven't prayed, when we haven't been obedient, when there's no prosperity there, even where our children are concerned. When God has made a clear command to us, we said, Lord, I think I'm going to do it my way. Yet there has been no productivity on their part and on our part. Maybe you're like Abraham and said, well, you know, I got rich now. You may have very well had some things and still find yourself right back spiritually where you was before. So we find out to the point where Lot began to backslide on God when he made a choice to leave God out of his life. He put God in the closet, Bishop. Many times we get so involved in our own personal pursuits, and it's an easy thing to do, church. I don't mean to talk down, but I want to just be truthful today. When we begin to seek our own will for our lives, most of the Lord, our walk requires waiting on God. The Bible says, "Look in your patience, rest in your souls." your ability to have a strong mind and for your will to be tied to God's will, rest in your willing to wait on him. James said we have need of patience in times of temptation. That's a good one. When I'm struggling with things that tempt me that are against God's will, and I want it so ebulliently, God said, just give it 10 seconds. Give it 10 seconds. Breathe, Johnny. Breathe, Johnny. Breathe, Johnny. Breathe. And if I could just be, God said, this too shall pass. Somebody say patience. Say wait on God. When we decide to go our own way, it does not mean I'm not saved. It means that the devil is fighting me. He wants to take me away from the good things of God. And don't you want good things? Somebody say good things. Say wonderful things. Say good and perfect gifts. That's what God gives. But he does it when we trust him and do his will. Now, I've just got to the point where I'm getting older and I don't have time for no foolishness. I feel like that I have a long history where I didn't obey God, and then I had to reap the despair, the hurt, the tears, the crying, the confusion, the lack of peace, and say, Lord, I'm going to trust you. Abraham was not unlike us. He had times in his life where he didn't trust God either. He had times in God where we'll show you how he blamed the father of our faith. The progenitor of our faith, the one who went before us, like Jesus, had time when he went the opposite direction. I've talked to people who moved to new cities. They left church. And the first thing I prayed to them, I said, find a good church to go to. We do not force anybody to stay, and we don't beg nobody to leave. But I'll tell you this, wherever you go, find a Bible-teaching church connected to God's people where you can serve God. And what I find out is many of them, they get there, they get the money, they get a big house, and then they begin to fall apart. Listen to me, church. And I'm telling you the truth. Because you can get gain. Bob said that Abraham got very rich in Egypt. He had no business in Egypt. God told him to stay in Canaan. He left at a time when there was a famine. You see, a lot of times, a lack of things causes us to start trusting in other things. You see, especially where money's concerned. So, Lord, you ain't providing like I need you to provide, man. Come on, I need some money now. I'm getting up in age, and my pocket ain't fat. Like my partner got a scheme. I can make $4,000 this week. I know it ain't going to necessarily line up with what I ought to be doing. But, Lord, I don't know if I can trust you now. So Abraham went down to Egypt in time of famine where he should have trusted God. Yeah. Abraham, the father of faith. The great Abraham, not trusting God. Getting rich outside of God's will. And not only that, but God told him, leave your house, leave your household and everyone there. And he took old nephew Lot. You know, as people, we love our uncles, don't we? Don't you love your aunt? Don't she let you do stuff mama won't do? Don't he let you do stuff? Yeah, boy, I'll tell you what. My uncle's like, when I was young, if I could get hooked up with an uncle, I could get anything I wanted. Not all of them, but I'm talking about, come on now, you know I'm telling the truth. This is what we're doing, uncle and nephew, okay? Abraham loves Lot. He loved Lot. He didn't want to leave him. But even when God says go, it don't matter if you love him or not. If God says it's time to go, you got to go. We used to say in the songs, but God said move. Oh, we got some church folk in here. You got to move. And if you don't move, you're going to get left behind. Oh, come on. Now I'm talking about the prosperity God wants to give you. It's based on your ability to move when God says move. Leave who God told you to leave. Hallelujah. If you want to be blessed, we have to stop listening and trying to do stuff on our own and start listening to God's word. Stuck in the middle. Just like Israel, when they came out, a two-week trip cost them 40 years. How do you make a two-week drive, 40-year drive? I'll tell you how, by not obeying the clear instruction of the Lord through his word. Hallelujah. But when need and trust in his word, it is a beautiful garment about thy neck. That's why Solomon said, trust in the Lord with all your heart and live. lead not into your own understanding. Hallelujah. Remember, he said, let not mercy and truth forsake thee, bind them about thy neck, write them on the tables of thy heart, and so shall you find favor in the sight of God and man. Hallelujah. There's favor that comes with trusting God. There's good health that comes with trusting God. Hallelujah. Prosperity comes with trusting God. Joy comes when we got a made up mind to trust the Lord. The blessings of the Lord make you rich, and they don't add no sorrow. A drunk can get joy, but he wakes up with a hangover. But this joy I have, Sister Eda, the world didn't give it, and the world can't take it away. And when I wake up in the morning, hallelujah! Brother Mauricio, I still got joy, because I got it from the Lord. The fount of every blessing. Hallelujah. Remember that old song? Come thy fount of every blessing. Tune my heart to sing thy grace. Hallelujah. People leave and they find out that the new job, the new money, and they've left God out. And it's only a matter of time before this whole family separates and divorced. A beautiful family. Oh, wonderful. Everything wasn't perfect, but other people would see, I wish I was a part of that. But seeing no value of bringing God into my prosperity. Not knowing that he is the source of every good thing.
Amen.
As we apply this, we need to include the Lord in all that we do. It doesn't matter whether it's considering a move to a new location or a new job. A lot of times, I put in for a job and I was just crushed when it didn't happen. And then after a while, then I was crushed again. And then I put it in, and then the Lord said, you see what's going on here? And that job wasn't no good for you. That's why they didn't give it to you. And I don't give no bad gifts. I don't give anything bad. I don't give bad boyfriend. I don't give bad girlfriend. And you got that, you did that outside of God. That's why I don't counsel people too much when they come to get married, because they done made up their mind when they get to the pastor's office. You hear what I'm saying? They know what they're going to do already. They're looking for one answer. You know what that answer is? Whatever answer they decide they're going to do. But I'll give you this question. I'm going to get back on track. A lot of times people get divorced because they weren't supposed to be married. Did you ask God about that? So, no, I didn't. Look, whatever you did outside of the will of God, you have to stay outside of his will keep. You take that one with you. There was a path where backsliding led Lot. It led Lot. Instead of being led by God, his backsliding led him. Okay? We say that sin takes you further than you want to go and keeps you longer than you want to be staying. If you ever had some company that comes in and you know that you got to come up with a scheme quick to get rid of them, they're not going to leave, says the Edith. How? What am I going to do? I'm going to say, I got something in the oven. Let me turn the oven on this white line. I'm about to cook something. All right, baby. I'm going to talk to you later. All right, now. God bless you. Sin keeps you longer than you want to stay. It takes you further than you wanted to go. One writer, I don't know if he was biblical or not, but he said, oh, what tangled webs we weave. What am I set out to deceive? One lie, I got to make up another lie. I told my wife I was down at the VP. She said, who was at the VP? Deep was at the VP. Then find out that Deep works with her. Deep told me I wasn't at the VP. I said, oh, I thought there was somebody else. And those six lies, thought I only needed one. It takes you further than you wanted to go. It keeps you longer than you wanted to stay. That's it. This is the course that led David's sin. Remember, he committed adultery, but it didn't stop there. Well, first, you're supposed to be out there fighting. And now, you done looked at Bathsheba. So you weren't supposed to look at Bathsheba, because Bathsheba looked good. Amen. You weren't supposed to look at her. You're supposed to be like Job said, I made a covenant with my eyes. Sometimes my wife will walk up on me and I'm scrolling, and you know, if you're on Facebook, you never know what's going to come up. She said, what you looking at? Nothing. Sin always comes in front of the way you want to go. Keeps you longer than you want to be kept. The principle is something people don't see. You can't just lust a little bit of sin and stop sinning. Listen, this is the problem. You're trying to lust a little bit, but you can't just lust a little bit. Whatever one of them cookies or something said, you can't just take one bite. And you can't take a chip or something. No. There is a temptation that's bigger than you are. You hear what I'm saying? Even with your saved self, there's a temptation that is greater than you are. There's a chip that you have to take a second bite. My God. It's just, you can't just lust a little and stop sinning. Sin, which is not dealt with, and certainly leads to more sin. We get a few ants in our house toward the end of the winter. And sometimes I'll try to get them. My wife, she goes get the bleach and starts. I said, do we need bleach? She said, yeah, if you want to get rid of them, they're going to be back. Wiping ain't going to do no good. Are you sure? I paid $4 for that little squirt bottle. She said, if we don't hit them with the bleach, they'll be back. Sin has to be expunged right at the source, and the source is the heart. That's where we ask the Lord to come and deal with it. Don't ask the Lord when you wake up in somebody's bed. Ask him way before that when your eyes start looking. That's the trouble. Don't worry about the bed. If you put mind in secret matter in the bed, you need to pray to God when you say, Lord, ask God to help me. This is what the Bible says. This is what we say. I'm in control, and I can put the brakes on anytime I want. You know, I've just been looking at these videos, and I can get this under wraps anytime I want. I only do it at this time of the day and this time of the week, and it's a small thing. This is what the Bible says. A little leaven leavened the whole lump. You see what I'm saying? I'm cheap, Brother D. I'm cheap. So if the bread starts molding in the front, I'm just going to peel it back essentially until I get where I need to be. My wife said, doing all that. I don't trust none of it. And she's the health professional. But here I come with my little degree. My associate's grounds, I think I learned it. You ain't learned nothing. We need to get rid of this whole thing. Ain't no telling what done happened. Yeah. Now, the first three pieces are all green. I said, honey, just let me keep working to the back. I got four pieces in the back that I think we can use. Would you like me to make a turkey sandwich? No. She says, no, I don't want a turkey sandwich. Think I'm going to Chick-fil-A. You can't have a little bit of sin in your life as a Christian. It's going to spoil everything. This is what the Bible says. I love it. It says, help me, Lord Jesus. Help me, Lord Jesus. Better is an ounce of heartsease than a whole bunch of gold. I've learned that I would rather just have peace in my heart than have to carry around clear, unconfessed, unrepentant sin in my life. Amen. Because I love God. And there's a conflicting portion in my life where I'm trying to live for him and then I'm carrying this sin. It's hard, I'm telling you. What I've learned is, if I ain't got nothing else, I'm just happy just saying, Lord, at least I ain't got this foolishness with me. I ain't got to be rich. I ain't got to have no woman. I ain't got to have nothing. As long as I could just have peace with me and my Lord and shut that house, and I ain't got folks calling and blowing up my phone and throwing stuff in my front yard because Ronnie was talking to Terry and Terry was talking to Judy. Just to be able to say, I got an ounce of heart seed. It's worth a ton of gold. Hallelujah! The perverse disputing of men of corrupt minds, supposing that gain is godliness, that from such withdraw thyself. You know, Paul said, told Timothy, thou man of God, flee these things. David found himself in a position where it wasn't time to start a prayer chain, David. Flee. Flee. Some of us trying to pray stuff out that God wants you to run from. So I'm going to pray her out. You keep on praying. But God told you to flee some very clear things that you know is too tough for you. I'm preaching better than y'all talking. If it's been whooping you for 15 years. When I was younger, I used to listen to Richard Pryor when my dad wasn't around. But Richard Pryor used to joke around. He said a joke, and I still remember it today. He said, I had a cousin that said cocaine wasn't addictive. He said he been snorting for cocaine for 15 years and he ain't hooked. You've been snorting for 15 years and you're not hooked? Well, congratulations. That is awesome. We have to be honest with ourselves. This thing has made a fool of me. It's whooped me real good. I'm done with you. I don't know, some of y'all like to watch fighting. Brothers, we watch that MMA and boxing, don't we? There was a guy, a black guy, named Israel Adesanya. He fought the Mexican dude. Mexican dude had beat him 3 times. And finally, he knocked that dude out. And they said, "Are you going to give him a rematch?" He said, "No." He said, "He's going to have to wait like I waited." He said, "He's going to fight somebody else. I'm the champ now. You're going to have to wait." You hear what I'm saying? But he realized and was honest enough, this guy beat me a whole bunch. I ain't getting back in the ring with him, not today. You go fight somebody else for a while. And we have to be honest about the fact that we've been whooped. Sin will whoop you. Sin will whoop you and tear you up. It'll put deep lines in your face and wrinkle up your face and make you look older than what you're supposed to look. But if you walk in the ways of the Lord, hallelujah. Worry and stress and my stuff God don't want you to have in your life, and people and even family like Lot who ain't thinking about God. Somebody got to go to the well water place. Somebody got to walk in the flesh. Somebody got to walk by sight. But somebody like Abraham and say, "I've been here before, and Lord, I got a made up mind to serve you. Wherever you go, I'm going the opposite direction. Don't really matter to me because I know you ain't spiritual no matter. But I got a made up mind." You see, Abraham had failed God before. He went out and remember he lied to Abimelech. Sometimes we say that our lying is in the will of God. Devil is a liar. Flat out lie, but you know what? He ended up getting rebuked by an evil king. An evil king rebuked him. As a child of God, unsaved folks ain't supposed to be rebuked. You don't hear what I'm saying. But it's a few and far between things to be rebuked in the house of God. Very patient, very slow, dealing with each other in love. But if someone who ain't even saved and rebuking, here he is. All he had to do was trust God. He didn't have to lie. He could have took Sarah, his wife, right up in the Abimelech's house, said, "This is my lady. I'm trusting God to keep her and protect her." Yeah. But he lied. Well, we found out at the point, there comes a point where he came back and he said, "I'm going to trust God now." Yeah. Okay? The price backsliding cost a lot. Everything. He lost his family. Yeah. He brought shame on his life. He disgraced his whole life because he was walking by sight. Yeah. And you got to close your eyes in this life. In this world, it's a wicked place. He didn't understand that we were pilgrims and strangers here. And we're only here for a time. And we have to trust God for the name that we serve a good God. But Abraham understood. The Bible said that he made an altar. And an altar is a beautiful thing. An altar was a wonderful place to be at. You see, in the Old Testament, they made physical altars. Because they understood when you come to God, something got to die. And it ain't the Lord. Your will got to die. Your desires got to die. Your lust got to die. Your habits got to die. Something got to die. Bible says that Christians have an altar, but those that are non-religious, non-Christians have no right to eat. What he's trying to say that there is an altar that we can come to, and that altar is the altar of cross of Calvary. Hallelujah. Where there we can eat and be well nourished off the broken body of Jesus, off the shed blood of Jesus that gives us forgiveness, that we find like Abraham knew even before the story was told. That like the prodigal son who had wasted all his money on women and drugs, that their father still had open arms. He didn't shame him, that we can always come back to God regardless of where we've been. And that God don't shame us, that he don't expose us. He just wants you to come on back to him. He'll throw a party for you today if you just say, "Lord, I'm back. I know I've been astray. I know I ain't been doing the right thing. But I got my mind set back on you." Hallelujah. I learned something. I was saying that David said it was good that I've been afflicted. He taught me how to walk in his way. I don't discount the things that happened to my life. The Bible says all things work together for good. To them who love the Lord.
Yes.
Who are called according to his purpose.
Yes.
Not all good things. All things. Even in our backsliding state, God is still good.
Yes.
David said, if I descend to hell, God is there.
Yes.
If I descend up to heaven, God is there.
Yes.
We know that he is always there for us.
Yes.
Backsliding cost Israel 70 years in Babylon. It cost them oppression by the heathen nations.
Yes.
In the dark days of the judges. Backsliding cost Naomi her whole family. But you know what trusting God got Ruth. Backsliding cost Saul his kingdom.
Yes.
Remember, first thing God told Saul was to kill the Philistines, the Amalekites? Israel, help me. Amalekites? And when David made king, what did he tell David? Are you going to do what Saul wouldn't do? God's will never changes. That's part of being a strong Christian. You say, Lord, well, I know I didn't get the third course math, and I ain't worried about that, but I'd like to go in geometry. You're not going anywhere. We're going to go back over the algebra lesson because you can't understand the goodness of God until you've been to the courses. Do you see, acknowledge God in every season. Backsliding cost David his son, his child. And if these things cost these men these things, don't think because we got the blood of Jesus on your life that our disobedience isn't costing you something every day. That's when you start getting strong. When you stop trying to lie and say, oh, grace covers everything and it's all good. Yeah, yeah. No. The first time grace is mentioned in the Bible as a fundamental Christian doctrine, the Bible says Noah found grace in the sight of God. Found is the active participle grammatically. What he was saying was he was looking for it. See, a child can be found. They wasn't looking for God. Nobody ever found grace. They wasn't looking for it. I'm telling you the truth because you can't have education without salvation. You can't have salvation without education. Now, how can I know these things unless someone tells me? You hear what I'm saying? So knowing and understanding, being educated, being fed with knowledge and understanding is why we need to come to church. It's how you grow. Okay? But David lost his son and peace in his household and the kingdom. Some of us suppose that there's no consequence to sin and no price to pay. Jesus paid it all. All to him on the own. Yeah, I get it. But that does not remove the fact that the wages of sin is death, even physically. If we go out to say something, the Bible says that Abraham found himself black at the same place that he was. I don't want to repeat no lessons at 50. I'm almost 50. I don't want to repeat no lessons. I've had that lesson before. I got wrecked by that. And I'm not saying I'm perfect. I struggle and stuff. But I've learned that, Lord, just get me back on track. Help me. I'm going to work with you. We're co-partners. If we're joint heirs, we got to be joint partners. But it's me leaning on you and trusting you. And grace it cannot be apart, and faith cannot be apart from works. The Bible says in Ephesians that we are created for good works. For that very purpose, we're created to do God's good works. Okay? Keep in mind, the Bible says this. Just like Abraham got rich, the Bible says there's pleasure in sin for a season. A season. I had pleasure in sin as a youngster, and last month I just paid my last child support. I'm not trying to be funny. I'm being as honest as I can. Not what I wanted. I wasn't married. I was just enjoying the pleasure of sin for a season. Not realizing that I'm going to have to pay for this. Never think that God has forgotten about what you did wrong. We pay for our sin. You hear what I'm saying? Jesus paid for it legally. But if you go out and shoot somebody, you're going to spend some time in jail. You hear what I'm saying? So we have to be honest about our decisions in our mind, because the Bible says it's with the mind you do what? Serve the Lord. He said, well, I thought I'd serve my body. You do, but it just starts in your mind. And when your mind gets off, he said, Lord, help me. And your mind gets off when you don't use the spirit that gives you a spirit of power and love and a strong mind. Yeah, the Lord's not giving us a spirit of fear, but power and love and self-discipline, which is all here. And when you have a mind to be self-disciplined, how do you get a self-discipline? While leaning on the Holy Spirit. It's not something you get from the Army or from the Navy or from some your discipline. No. Your strong mind comes from leaning on God. Trusting God for his goodness and his grace. For delighting in his word. Principal points I'm about to. Sometimes life puts us on the move. I came here and I knew my marriage was coming to an end. And I just had to leave all the extra religious folks alone and telling me that I need to be in a hellish marriage. God's going to bless me. Because I didn't ask him when I did that first one. No. So in my mind, I had already trusted God, but he did not release me. He didn't release me, so I stayed. We weren't even together, and I still stayed. But life put me on the move. Life put Abraham on the move. Come out from your country. And sometimes it's just hard, Dean, when God puts you on the move. It's the toughest part in life. It's when God puts you on the move. See, me and my wife, we enjoy life together. We ain't moving nowhere.
Amen.
But we've been on the move before. When the relationship wasn't right. When it wasn't yielding nothing. We knew we didn't trust God when we first did it in the first place. Maybe it was a job that I'm moving from, moving to a new city, moving from anything. Anytime you're on the move, it's not easy, child of God. It's rough. Now, Abraham was not perfect. That's why I love the Bible. Because I could put myself in his shoes. The Bible says he lied to Abimelech. He got rebuked. The Bible tells us the father of our faith disobeyed God by going to Egypt, trusting God in times of scarcity. That's when we really want to really go outside the will of God. Is when, Lord, I'm not getting the affection that I need. I'm not getting the love that I need. This is what I really want. That's when God starts trying you and testing you and proving you. He said, I just want somebody that's right in the eyes of the Lord. Go throughout the world trying to find somebody to show themselves strong in him. And they want to be that person like Isaiah when the Lord comes. Said, Lord, I'll go. Who shall go? I'll go. Anybody willing to go this morning? Despite being on the move. Despite being in the places you don't want to be. Bible says that he took Lot with him and it cost Lot his whole family. Physically, but men's in refusal to serve God cost their family spiritually. Wow. Bob said we shouldn't fear him who kills the physical body and can do no more. That's the devil. That's evil. He said, well, we ought to fear the one who can destroy the body and the spirit, cast both into hell. You see what I'm saying? So spiritual life is way more important than what your child is doing physically. As parents, as men, we kill our own children spiritually. And I'm not saying eternally, but we cut them off from the very blessing that God designed when we don't do what we're supposed to do. And us doing what we're supposed to do ain't no guarantee they're going to do what they're supposed to do. But that has nothing to do with what we're supposed to do. Well, let me tell you what. Bible says, it's a shepherd and the sheep shall be scattered. But there is a particular action that happens when the head ain't doing what the head's supposed to do. And as men, keep serving the Lord, men. I love you in this church. Keep serving God. Give yourself a hand. Give yourself a hand. Thank yourself to God. A couple more things. Okay. Even though Abraham came back from Egypt, he returned to the place he was. A lot of times in life, we have to repeat steps. And we don't want to repeat steps. Essentially, Abraham's time in Egypt, even though he got rich, was wasted time. Because he was right back where he was before. God could have and would have provided for, he would have provided for Abraham in Canaan.
Yeah.
If he had stayed there in the time of drought.
Yeah.
The time that God touched my heart the most.
Yeah.
Is when I was separated from my family and my wife, and I didn't have a single person in 2012, and I came to Muncie. It was just me and the Lord. And it was the dearest time I've ever had in my life. That's not to take nothing away from anybody.
Yeah.
But there's no communion like the communion you have with Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Amen. Yeah. Don't ever forget. Job said, God, my maker,
yeah,
who gives me song in the nighttime.
Yeah. Yeah.
God, only God can inspire,
yeah,
a song, yeah, when there ain't no music.
Yeah.
Woo! My God, I thank him today. Abraham should not have used his blessing that God brought him to Egypt and his justification going there. The fact that God, you don't see God's clear hand to get you in judgment and you know you're not doing the wrong thing, don't let that confuse you. Don't let that confuse you. God, the Bible says he is slow to anger. He did not forget it. He's slow to anger. Okay? He hadn't forgot anything. Don't use the fact that nothing has happened or prosperity as a sign that I'm in God's will. And when it comes to getting rich and having prosperity, honey, no one has more money in this world than the cartels. But they're taking people apart. They ain't got a bit of God in them. So money and things ain't got nothing to do with your spirituality. You hear everybody should have said amen. That means I'm blessed despite being rich. My true blessings are not money, a thing, a possession. And if I don't have it, I'm still good. My true riches are inside. And the Bible says that her true riches are contrite spirit and the Holy Ghost is in dormant. Hallelujah. I love a woman when I see a woman who got the Holy Spirit dripping off of her. I love her. It beats a little short skirt and a bunch of lipstick. To see a woman that is grace and goodness and preachable for God's word. Hallelujah. That good, fruitful tree that you've been coming in from us. And glory to God. Hallelujah. What a blessing. Hey, I shout out my boys. Hallelujah. Thank God for what he's done in our lives. To the place of the altar which he had made there first. And Abraham called on the Lord. He sometimes God has to bring us back to a familiar place.
Yeah.
I'm driving 65, and from 65 going to Indianapolis, if you head south, you can look over and see Christ Temple Apostolic Church. And I remember how I was broken there as a kid, 1985, 1984. And I remember my mother's promise. She said, you're going to be a preacher. You're going to preach. And so when I got off in life, doing things and all not doing drills and carrying on. I always had the reminder, I was doing something illegal when I drove past it.
Yeah.
I had some things stuffed all in, I had a brand new Escalade.
Yeah.
Then you had no job, $70,000 car.
Yeah.
Tell the truth. But I drove past it. Sometimes God will take you to a familiar place.
Yeah.
And I drove over and I said, Christ, the boy, I was on church. Water just coming. $30,000, $40,000 in the car. And when God saved me, I got rid of everything I had. I had cars and money. I had all this. Tens of thousands of dollars. Hundreds of thousands of dollars. I got rid of it all. I'm saying you have to have a made up mind. You don't want God to bring you out of Egypt. And you have Egypt stuff in your pockets. Carry an Egypt with you wherever you go. God, what kind of example can you be acting like an Egyptian? I've always been committed to whatever I was doing. So if I was riding around and getting it, then I was riding around and getting it. But when I served the Lord, I said, I'm going to give it 100%. Nobody wants no halfway thing. Nobody wants no halfway work. No halfway hook. Go on with yourself. You know somebody fully committed, they got their mind made up. My wife and Darnetta came in here and cleaned the church last night. She left the house late. And I said, okay, I'll talk to you later. And after about 15 minutes, I said, I got to go to the church. Can't leave two women at the church when it's dark. I got here and pat myself on the back. She said, you're a true man. You could have sent a home, but you got one over here. You hear what I'm saying? Well, we're following the lead of the Lord. He'll tell you what to do. We always listen to women, and they said, a real man does this, and a real man does that. A real man serves the Lord. That's it. Put that one in the box. A real man serves the Lord. He doesn't come up to what God wants. He'll never be pleasing to you. And if you don't come up with what God wants for you, man, you'll never be pleasing to her. Trying to be pleasing outside the will of God. How? How? That ain't gonna work. Matthew 6:33. Seek ye first. I got a Bible reader. The kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all everything else. He didn't say might. He didn't say it could be. He said it will be added unto you. Hallelujah. Now, when we just trust God and say, Lord, I'm going to get the same. I need more than what I could have got outside of the will of God. I missed that old Escalade, but we pushed the 550 Benz now. Hey, he knows what you like. He knows how to deliver. It took me about 10 years, but I got it. I got it. Say, Lord, for God I live, and for God I die. Sometimes you got to be like Daniel in the lion's den. Say, Lord, if you deliver me good, and if you don't deliver me, I'm still not going to battle. Hallelujah. That's a true Christian. That's a made up mind. It ain't based upon if I get what I thought I should have got. Lord, I trust you regardless of where I'm at, how I failed you, how I may miss the mark. You got to quiet the noise of other people and what they say. He done did the exact same thing. I'm going to trust God in every situation. Hallelujah. I like this about Abraham. Instead of torturing himself, because sometimes as Christians, you beat yourself up more than anybody beat yourself up. That Bible says if you get alone, that's a place that's unreasonable. People exclude themselves in Proverbs. He said they're selfish and throw out all reason. Stop spending so much time thinking by yourself. So, especially if you know the devil's there. Sometimes I got to get up out of my house because the devil's getting me. You know, I'm not going to get out of here. This is nothing. He's going crazy today. Let me get out of here. So you have to get somewhere else around the people of God. Because he will win sometimes in a one-on-one battle. You ain't Jesus. You ain't Jesus. You got a down payment of your inheritance. Now, in him dwell all the fullness of the Godhead body. We got a 10%. What's the down payment? About 10%? Yeah, you about 10% saved. That's sanctification. That's a fact. But he didn't beat himself up about a sin. He got busy doing what was next, what needed to be done. As a Christian, the lower you get, older you get, the more you walk with God, you realize that trouble is always there. The Bible says, the man that's born a woman, his days are short and full of trouble. And you get to realize that, I know I can't let this stop me from getting to church every week because it's going to be right there next week. I know I can't let this stop me from turning to God. That's the role of the pastor. Build you up in the most holy faith to get you to stop letting small things stop you from getting to the house of God, get you from serving God, get you to have a made up mind for once, to trust God in all times. Hallelujah. As a church, we have to decide where you're at. Am I one of those people that's hokey pokey? We got one foot in, one foot out, through the hokey pokey, and turn himself about. Don't be no hokey pokey sick. Abraham, he returned to living as a tent, as a pilgrim, and using altar as a worship. He went back to his first days as basically a beginner. He got rich. He enjoyed the world. And when he got back to God's will, guess where he was at? Right where you start. The Bible says in Hebrews, it said they should have been teachers, but they had to be taught again. He spent all that time in the world, came back to God, and you don't go to second grade, you're right back in the first grade. He had to leave in the elementary principles, remember, of doctrine, of baptism, and repentance. He said, now let's go back over. There's something we was on geometry. You didn't pass algebra. The Bible says it is most important that a steward be found. We got one faithful person. If you want God to use you, you got to be faithful. There's no way you're going to be using this church until you're faithful. Faithful. Did I say perfect? Did I say sinless? What did I say? What did the Bible say? What are you going to be? What do you thank God for? Be a faith. You have to be faithful. You have to be faithful. And you have to have a made-up mind to serve the Lord. There's a lot of things you have to have a made-up mind to do. Anything good, you have to have a made-up mind. They questioned LeBron James the other day. Some dude was asking him and told him he was old and couldn't hoop and all this stuff. They talked to LeBron about the game, and then they got toward the end, and LeBron, they talked about the guy, and LeBron said, I don't want to talk about him. I won't tell you, he's not significant. He has nothing. I have a made up mind. They didn't win the game. As a Christian, stop letting small things bug you. As a pastor, yeah, I'll tell you, there's a whole bunch of stuff tries to bug me. but you have to have the same mind. My father used to say, don't one monkey run no show. He was talking about this monkey. And I'd be starting stuff. He was 6'4", 260. And I would let him have it. But he would not move too much. He would just wait till I came by, and then he'd grab me and say, hey, remember what you said earlier? Then he'd tie me up. But as a Christian, if you're going to have a made up mind, stop letting stuff bug you. Stop letting stuff stop you. Stop making excuses for why you can't serve and why you can't do this. Remember Moses? What did Moses say why he couldn't serve God? What did he say? He said, did what?
He never said
that. God don't need you to be perfect to do nothing for him. He doesn't need you to be loved and available. He just needs you to be have a made up mind about what you're going to do. He wants to shut you down each week in your worship and praise. Say, don't worship God. You know what you did Wednesday. Shut up. That's what you need to tell Satan. Bible says, get me behind me. You can say, shut up. Be quiet. Yeah, women say that they really have a bad attitude toward men. They said, I know when he's lying when he opens his mouth. You can say the same thing about the devil. And you up there listening to a liar? I would say he's the accuser, not of the world, of the brethren. This is where he starts the foolishness. And this is when you know it's the devil talking, because it's accusatory. She don't like me, or and she ain't looking at me. I ain't talk to her. But he's telling you what she's thinking. Well, he's a liar. Holy Spirit don't work like that. And it opens us up to love and forgiveness. It don't open you up to accusation and claims and condemnation. The Holy Spirit, if you really walk in the Spirit, you got open arms. You got a heart full of love and a heart full of grace. And then that grace surely comes from the fact that you know God is always there. If we maxed in today, I want you to come. Elders, come. We're going to pray this morning. Somebody needs to come back to the Lord. Many of us need to come back to the Lord. We're going to trust God afresh this morning. Thank Him for His goodness. God said, if any person has a need, Bishop, come. Mr. Lane, come. Mr. Tricia's, Darnetta, come on up here. If you want prayer, God is going to do something for your life today. He told me last night. And we call on you to come. We want to pray for you. Come on, is anyone? Somebody come today. God wants to bless you. Come on up here. God wants to do something for you. Today is you can't get nothing from God. You have not because you ask not. God don't superimpose himself on anyone today. Come on. Come on up here. Let's get y'all up here. If you need something from God, from the smallest thing to the greatest, hallelujah, you know you need. This is a shameful thing. This is an intelligent thing. Hallelujah. Bible says God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. The power is not in the oil. The power is in prayer. But there's a power in obedience. He said, if we call on the Lord, hallelujah, let them anoint you with oil. That's what it said. We trust God. We don't trust God not alone. We trust the God who said it. Hallelujah. If anybody calls on the name of the Lord, hallelujah, you shall be healed. You shall be blessed. Power is not enough, but the power is in God today. Whatever you want today, you can begin to open your mouth, come on, and tell God what you want, and God is going to bless you today. It doesn't matter what you did. If Abraham can be blessed, I know that I can be blessed. Hallelujah. Went the wrong way, but when he was done, he put his faith back in God. Let's just raise our hand to begin the blessing. Hallelujah is the highest praise. Whatever you say today, nothing to be greater than hallelujah. It means to God be the glory. Glory to God in highest. Father God, we thank you right now for your goodness. Help us to open our mouth and begin to bless you. You know our hearts today and the things that this church needs. We may have not been perfect, but we turn our hearts back to you today. Hallelujah. You said in your word, hallelujah. Hallelujah. If my people that are called by my name humble themselves, hallelujah, turn from their wicked way and call on the name of the Lord, you restore us. Father God, I decree and declare restoration. Restoration in relationship. Restoration of bank account. Restoration of good health today. We turn our hearts to you. We set our mind like a bulwark. Hallelujah. To the God and the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run in and we are saved today. We thank you for your saving grace. Thank you for your love and your mercy today. Hallelujah. The blessings go up. The praises go up. Hallelujah. Send the blessing down. We lose heaven right now. We lose the blessing right here, right now. The things that the people of God need, touch us, fill us, manifest yourself above. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Lose the blessing. Hallelujah. Free the captive today. Clap your hands this morning. Somebody say hallelujah. Come on, lift your voice. Hallelujah. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, let's just worship him a little more right here. The presence of God is here. We'll get another blessing. Just call on it right now. Believe and receive. Touch the hem of his garment today and pray. Give him glory and honor today. We need more from you today. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, we thank you today. Thank you for forgiveness today. Turn our hearts back to you. Help us to remember the old past today. Hallelujah, we thank you, Father. We love you. Thank you for your faithfulness. Hallelujah. We're coming back to you in the name of Jesus for the power of your grace and mercy. Hallelujah. Thank you for a repentant heart today. Thank you for a made up mind today. Hallelujah. Touch every shaking mind. Touch every hokey pokey spirit. Set our hearts on your fresh today. Hallelujah. Renew Pentecost today. Lose the Holy Spirit today. We thank you, Lord Jesus. We demand and declare growth in our lives today. We're going to a higher place in you today. Greater anointing today. Enlarge our stage and decrease. Strengthen our cords today. We become more of you today. Hallelujah. We thank you for your sacrifice, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you for your substitutionary work. Thank you for the cross of Calvary today. Thank you for your shed blood today. Thank you for the stripes that we take and you take it. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor here today. In the name of Jesus, lose the blessing. Hallelujah. Lose the blessing, Lord. Lose the blessing, Lord. Come on, give him praise. Don't stop praising. Give him praise and say hallelujah. Tell him thank you for the blessing. Tell him thank you for the blessing. Tell him thank you for the blessing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We remove the guilt and the shame in this church right now. Through the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. To speak better things through the blood of Abel in the name of Jesus. It cries out forgiveness instead. Hallelujah. We thank you today. We praise you today. Hallelujah. Worship of God. Hallelujah. With your word today. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. David said, let my heart be not so with God. He has made with us an everlasting covenant, church. You don't need to be perfect to be blessed. We just need to be honest. If we confess our sins, he is willing and faithful to forgive us, cleanse us from unrighteousness. Hallelujah. If we confess our sins, he is faithful. Faithful. cleanse us, to wash us, forgive us from all unrighteousness today. We thank you for your word today and your promises today. They're true. In you they are yes and amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Strengthen every heart today. The bruised reed you shall not break. The smoking flax shall not quench today. Hallelujah. Strengthen the weak knees of our hearts today. Strengthen our faith today. Take somebody a higher faith today. Take somebody from in a halfway St. William home today. Strengthen somebody's body today. Help somebody to leave their nephew exactly where he ought to be. Help us to leave some of them shaking folk right where they ought to be and follow God today. Help somebody like Elijah to drop their mantle, drop their plow, Lord Jesus, and burn up everything that they have and follow God today. Hallelujah, you're able to light the flame of ministry today. Hallelujah, you ask that we might be faithful to you. Help us to remember the importance of faithfulness. Stop trying to be perfect, but remember, we ought to be faithful to God. Hallelujah, he shall perfect that which concerns me, hallelujah. Help us to trust and plan today. Hallelujah, help us to set our affection on you today. Help us to set our affection on the things above today. Help us to love you today afresh, hallelujah. Take us to a higher place in it today. Increase somebody's anointing today. Hallelujah. Increase the gifts in the Spirit today. Help somebody to see more fruit today. Help us somebody to see more gifts today. Help us to exercise our gifts today. Help us to walk in our ministry today. Help us to see God's will today. Help us to love one another today. Give us the oil of the Spirit to allow us to work well together. Hallelujah. Oil us today in the name of Jesus. Satan, we cast you out in the name of Jesus. We have no dominion here, no place here. Hallelujah. We consecrate this place afresh today. We're back to where we was, but we give you praise. You kept us in a dark land. You kept us in a land of famine. Hallelujah. But we give you praise this party time now. Hallelujah. The prodigal son has returned in the name of Jesus. The prodigal daughter has returned in the name of Jesus. It's party time now. Hallelujah. 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 We are moved together in the shame, hallelujah. And we're loose the power and the joy and the righteousness that is in the Holy Ghost today. Father, thank you. Thank you now, hallelujah. Touch someone's shoulder, find somebody's shoulder. Tell them you love them today. Bless God today. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah. Thank you. The Lord knows what we have need of here today. Loose the power of the Spirit today in a fresh way, hallelujah. There's always a greater place to go in God. None of us have made it. Hallelujah. Call us up to a higher level. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Call us up. Strengthen us. Hallelujah. Bring us to a new level today. We will not be what we was yesterday. We are something greater today. We're stronger today. We're wiser today. We will not return to the weak and beggarly things of this world. We thank you for the redemption that we have in Christ Jesus today. Who the Son sets free is free indeed today. We thank you, Lord. We will not bring Egypt with us. We'll lose that old golden idols of the past today. We declare that Jesus Christ is Lord. Come on, give him some praise today. Give him some praise today. In the name of the Lord. It's a strong tower. Righteous. We are singing. Give God the praise. Now, clap your hands. Come on, clap your hands. Clap your hands. When you made the middle class today, booze yourself and clap your hands. Come on, when the middle class booze yourself, give God the praise. This ain't no freezer, hallelujah. This ain't no cold storage. We can give God praise from the depths of our heart, hallelujah. Thank you for who he is, hallelujah. What he's able to do. Lord, we thank you today. Come on, give him another more praise. We got all week to worry about you. Give God praise in the sanctuary. Hallelujah. When the praises go up, sir, the blessings come down. He's not going to stop blessing. If you keep on praising, he's going to keep blessing. Some child is coming back to God today. One of your daughters is coming back to Jesus today. A friend and an honest to the Lord today. Hallelujah. We come against the past that condemned us today. And we are free in the name of Jesus. Walk in your calling today. Let no man judge you today. You have been cut free by the blood of Jesus today. Righteous by his blood. Sanctified by his blood. And come on, lift up your gates. Lift up your hands over the gates. Be lifted up everlasting door. King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is King of glory. Come on. Come on, church. The blessings are going up. The blessings are coming down. It's that time today. In the Old Testament, the blessings came down at the end. You had to wait for a little while. Your blessings still come down at the end. You got to know you're serious. You got to know you got a made up mind to serve. When the praises go up, come on, give them some praise. When your middle class moves yourself, give God some praise today. Come on, with your submitting self. Unbutton your suit, give God some glory today. That's right, give God. He's worthy of the praise today. You can give him praise today. He wants to bless you right now. All you got to do is just lift up your hand and say, thank you. Pop. Promotions are coming. Increase is coming. Money cometh in the name of Jesus. The devil is a liar. Hallelujah. We wish above all things that you prosper. Be in good health even as your soul prosper today. Hallelujah. Every prayer is answered today. Whatever you pray for today, he is faithful who promised. He's faithful who promised. Devil is a liar. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Even when the Son says free, free indeed today. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, give God some praise. Healing is here. Everlasting healing today. Hallelujah. The enemy that you saw before, you'll see no more. You don't believe it, but receive it anyhow. The enemy that you saw before, sickness is gone. You'll see it no more. Give God praise today. Poverty is gone. You won't see poverty no more. Give God praise. Depression, you're gone today in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We won't see you no more in the name of Jesus. Give God praise. You are made whole by your praise and your thanksgiving today. Only one came back. Let that one be you today. Only one leper came back and said, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. He was made whole today. Wholeness is seen as your ability to give God thanks. Give him praise. Give him glory and give him honor today. He's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He's the Alpha, the end, the Omega, the beginning and the end today. He's a lamb slain to the end of the world. Hallelujah. And he is the shepherd of the sheepfold. He's your all in all today. Give God praise today. Give one more blessing before you leave. Give God praise. One more blessing. Give God praise. Give him glory. Hallelujah. Yes, Jesus. We thank you. Hallelujah. Bless me now. Bless me, Lord. Bless me now. Just attention to you. We're going to give and we're going to get out of here. We're early still. Thank God. Don't forget your blessing today. When we leave today, don't forget whatever you ask God for. If you said it in faith, he's going to bless you. That is God's doing. God said it's marvelous in our eyes. We can't do nothing outside of God's will and be blessed. But today we decree and declare God has moved here. We are not staying where we was. We have stagnant portions of our life where we're stagnant. It's okay. But God doesn't want you to stay there. He wants you to get up and move to the next place. He doesn't want you to be ashamed about what happened. If he's forgotten, I've forgotten. Just keep on going forward in the name of Jesus. This time, if you have something to give, let's give. We still need giving. Summertime folks don't want to give. They get to moving. They're going on vacation. Don't forget God. If you got paid last week, you ought to have something to bring. Hopefully it's 10%. If you're really trusting me, be more than that. The Bible says the tenth is holy to the Lord. It didn't stop being holy because Jesus died on the cross. But a better covenant requires better promises, better output. Thank God for your faithful giving. We are a blessed body of people. God has supplied all of our needs today. And you're going to a greater place in the Lord today. or the chance God taking you to a higher place. Just stay in that word, stay in that Bible. Bless you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give him praise. This is praise. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You really love him. You really love him. Jesus said, if you deny me before man, I'll deny you before my Father in heaven. Jesus don't play. Never give Jesus cracking up. He was here on business. Let's stand. We're going to dismiss. Got any announcements? Brother Kim. Church. Keep serving God with faith. And it takes a made up mind. And that made up mind comes through following the Spirit of the Lord. Everyone with uplifted hands at the words of my mouth and the meditation in my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength, my redeemer. Hope somebody tell me why I'm good.
I like it.
was getting an application.
Maybe sometime, Ramsey and I sometimes go to breakfast or lunch. Would you like to join us sometime?
Yeah, well, you know, we're all going to get together, you know.
Yeah.
This fella here.
Yeah. Thank you.